Last summer, I had occasion through the Central Florida section of the Audio Engineering Society to witness a tour of Valencia College. I didn't know anything about Valencia College at all. I came away pretty impressed, and hopefully I can share some of that enthusiasm with you guys. Feel free to stop me, ask questions and stuff. I think a lot of things about the place were actually quite interesting. A little bit about Valencia College. It's a junior college system in Orlando. It ties to the University of Central Florida, some collection of junior colleges. The first question that's going to pop into your mind is, why are they doing this in a junior college? And I didn't know the answer to that, but the thing that really caught my eye was the fact that they advertised that they had a 44-speaker Dolby Atmos system, which I thought for an education facility, that's unusual. Okay, so I thought I better go take a look at this, and so we'll see what I saw here. The building is a brand new building. They built it last year. It was finished in March, and this was kind of the first public collection of Audio Engineering Society people to come see the place. These were the two principals who conducted the tour. Bob Katz basically arranged the thing. He's the leader of the Central Florida section, and I don't know if you know Bob, but he's a long time recording engineering producer type, and a fellow of the AES, and Raul Valeri is the director of the Music and Sound Technology program. He's the one who actually conducted the tour with a number of students, which, and I'll get into some of that later. I found the students very interesting. I apologize for the quality of the images. We were moving through the facility, which had more rooms than I could count, and it had and we were constantly in motion, so getting the pictures staged was kind of difficult. What you can't see that I'd like to show you, there were a number of elevated speakers along the walls. This is a Stewart film screen. This is the back of the hall, seats about 150 people. You can't see it very clearly, or maybe you can from where you're sitting, but there's speakers along the back wall too, four or five of them. So this is the first room that we're in, and this is kind of impressive. One thing you might notice, there's a surround subwoofer on each sidewall, which I think is unusual for theater spaces. So if you do the math, you're going to get up to 44 speakers when you see all this. But surround subwoofers is something I hadn't encountered before, so I found that unusual. And if you'll also notice, spacing of the speakers pretty close together. So they had a large number of surround speakers all the way around, and they had several up above, directly above, too. Again, the pictures don't do it justice, but film screening theater, I think a very high density speaker count, especially for a 150 seat room, right? Most places that you'll see, Regal Cinemas and so forth, several hundred seats, 300-400 seats, don't have this kind of speaker count. Another view of the back wall. So they didn't give us a tour of the projector room, but some of us snuck in there, take a look at what they had. It's a Christie 4K projector. It had a 7-inch optic diameter projection tube. I don't know if that's big or small or what I expected. I just made note of the fact that it was a 7-inch optic.
That's huge.
Yeah, that's yeah. Awesome. The screen quality seemed to be pretty good. I took a quick shot of the lighting, 1420 watts driving the 7-inch tube. Pretty nice projection setup. And if you're also like me, you're doing the calculation, what would a place like this cost? I mean, we should talk about that. Mm-hmm. Here's the rack of 8-channel Crown amplifiers and a Dolby Atmos interface, some other associated equipment. Again, they were kind of routing us through this quickly. I would have taken individual part number shots and things like that, but didn't really get time. I counted the lights lit up, so some of the amplifiers are not using full 64. So But 44 channels, you can get an idea here. This is a view behind the screen, and you can see that over here, all of the blown foam insulation for keeping the back wave reflection out of the main area. Just a first-class treatment, really. And everything up on a platform, because this these speakers were centered on the screen. So everything had to be raised up. You can see JBL, I think that stands for Just Big and Loud. That's a subwoofer. In the next picture, the left, center, and right arrays configured like this. Basically a horn tweeter, a three-cell mid-range box, and a folded horn midwoofer. So quite an impressive setup behind the screen. And this THX logo was under the film screen. Nobody seemed to know whether the whole theater was THX certified, but the screen was, evidently, and maybe the rest of the theater. They have a Dolby Atmos system, but the disc that they played was not Dolby Atmos. So we didn't get a demonstration of the system, and I'm not even sure they knew it, that they weren't demonstrating Atmos. So just kind of unfortunate, but it was still a very good system, still a very good video. So Stewart film screen, and there was Crestron automation. At the lectern, they had lights going up and down, and the curtains drawing and things like that. And I thought it was, you know, having a 44-speaker cinema presentation like this was unusual. Well, that wasn't the half of it. This place had quite a bit of brand new recording equipment and teaching equipment. These are Apple computers and student workstations with, see if I can remember the names of it, Axiom Pro keyboard with all sorts of effects and things I'm too old to learn. This was one of two different teaching rooms, and this is half of one of the rooms. So they could take as many as, it looked like, 60 students at one time. This is a 24/7 live radio control booth, and they were running live radio around the clock out of this particular studio. Here's one of the mixing consoles. They had Harrison consoles all over the place. The mastering lab, we spent some time in there. You can see again high density of surround speakers along the wall and up along the ceiling. And again, kind of hard to see, but let me see if I can pick them out here. Yeah, the front along the front wall here and here, and also back along the side upper walls. Somebody set them up with something fairly impressive. There's again a corner showing a low frequency box here and high frequency boxes. So even their mastering room had a you know, an Atmos configured system. Part of our group in here, a number of people, regular audio engineering societies, but a number of them also were retirees from Disney. So we had a number of interesting discussions about how this place came about, and I'll tell you about that in a moment. Again, another shot of the overhead speakers, and here's a view of the console area and the speakers in behind. There's perhaps a good picture of the density of the ceiling speakers, as well as the sidewall speakers. The opening to the Foley room, and this is the Foley room here, where it had more blown insulation here. And these were wall traps with perforated metal. I don't think the room was fully functional yet. The floor was still urethane, so it hadn't been conceived to finish that yet, but should be a pretty good Foley room. There's one of the Harrison mixing consoles, fairly sophisticated. This was a 2,500 square foot soundstage. All the walls are treated about a foot thick, could have been more, with traps and foam, blown foam insulation. the sound stage, the ceiling was maybe 30 foot. I think they said that they'd had marching bands in there before. Another shot of the sound stage. And a shot of the wall construction. Perforated steel, blown cellulose, and protective grids. This is one of the sound mixing rooms where they did purely audio, and you'll notice in the back of the room quadratic residue diffusers. Now, I took a close look at them, and I'm familiar with RPGs, Peter D'Antonio's diffusers. These had a different spacing on them, so I don't know if they were homebrew or built by somebody else. Obviously, different spacing, it gives you a different characteristic, but still the same purpose, omnidirectional reflection of the sound off the back wall. So you have to use more of them because the spacing is smaller, but it'll operate over a broader frequency, I would guess. Monitor speakers, they had quite a few different types of speakers, mostly Genelec and JBL. One of their sound mixing consoles. And this was a mini monitor, active mix cube is what they're using for a mini monitor, powered little device. This was a Genelec speaker that they had in the recording studios. And they had this app that would allow you to place the Genelec speakers where you want them, and it would do some level of pre-equalization in this program. That happened to be up on the screen when I walked through. I don't know if they were meaning to tell us that or what have you, but didn't know that Genelec, you know, was did a software app. There's another view of the recording studio, amplifier, electronics, so forth, and of course speakers in the control room, and more diffusers. There's a view of the recording studio console. And yes, they have a recording studio too, which is has portable traps and isolators, had slat absorbers. One of the old timers who was with me went up there with a pocket ruler he happened to have, and he checked the spacing on the spacers, on the slat absorbers, and he just nodded his head and walked away. I mean, it was a beautiful moment, you know. I loved it. So there's more views of the slat in, and there's some wall absorbers. So this room, they could have a serious ensemble for music. This is the isolation booth. It's right off the studio. Again, they didn't miss many tricks in this whole setup. And here's yet another recording studio with Genelec mini monitors up on the console. Then I took a walk outside because I was kind of overwhelmed. I wanted to see what was going on, and obviously they have remote trucks and trailers. They do live remote stuff out of this school too. When I was at school, we were lucky to get a pair of Heresies that we could do something with. These guys are really well equipped. Then they have this outdoor back patio configured so that they can do live amphitheater-like gatherings and recording off of these walls. And then there's a nice walking trail around the back of the place and a pond. You do have to watch out for alligators and snakes in this particular pond area, but a very, very nice, peaceful place to go. In talking with some of the old timers, Disney retirees and so forth, they gave me a few tidbits to think about. They didn't really know because Raul Valeri wasn't very forthcoming about where his funding came from. But they had a pretty good idea that this is being funded by Universal Studios, by Disney, and by the other entertainment venues in Central Florida. And the main reason is there is a very high-end recording arts company called Full Sail. Has anybody heard of that?
Yeah.
Full Sail is responsible for training most of the Disney technical people, technicians, operators, so forth. But can you guess how much they charge to train kids there?
$55,000, I think, is about the full course.
Exactly.
My son looked at it, but I had a chance to fly down there for $99 for a day.
Yeah.
They just filled it up full of people who wanted to see the place, a whole plane, and they. For the whole day, they treated us like royalty, ran us through that place, and the guy gave a, they started the place, gave a speech about how he went to the AES show, and it's a fascinating place. And
yeah.
If I wanted to teach or if I wanted to learn, that's where I would go.
Yeah.
I took one guy out of there that went on to work with me for a little while, Tater McCarthy, that lives around our Detroit area. But he's gotten 6 times Monitor Engineer of the Year from Front of House magazine and the awards that they give out to the touring companies.
So this place, Full Sail, that we're talking about, you know, $50,000-$60,000+. When we asked what it would cost a student to go through this, 64 credit hours, they said, well, what's junior college tuition these days? Oh, you got to be kidding me. I said, that can't be. And so the old timers who were with me said, well, this equipment, you know, just appeared out of the blue. They didn't have to buy it. Okay, well, what do you mean? He said, well, here's the problem for Disney. Disney would hire somebody out of Full Sail. They would have to make X number of dollars to pay for their Full Sail education, which meant that they needed higher pay than Disney was paying in Orlando. So they would go out to the West Coast and they would work Hollywood or work, you know, the theaters or, you know, get into television business, go where the money is, right? Disney was having trouble keeping people. This hasn't been confirmed. I'm speculating this. I think that Disney and Universal are subsidizing this. So when the kids go through this, they pay less than $10,000 and they get an associate's degree, right? And they live at home with mom or whatever, or live in an apartment with 3 other guys, and they're getting this education. And we had a number of students with us going around the place. I don't think they have a clue how lucky they are. I really don't. I think they're like, okay, I'm doing this, and you know, hopefully someday I'll make some money at it. What they do say, what the Valencia College website will tell you, is that the starting salaries are on the order of $30,000. That would not attract a lot of people, but if you can get some competent trainees for you know, $30,000, you know, you're going to be doing all right. That's my guess of how all this came about. A brand new building in a junior college east of Orlando, you know, so it's got a benefactor. I mean, you know that, and they're just charging regular rates. So I would suggest that if you you know, if you have a family member or a friend who wants to get into the business, they check this place out. It might be a good start for not a lot of money. Are there any questions? Thanks. Anybody? Yeah, Dave?
I've heard comments come out of the recording facility at the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor, even from its faculty or related people, that in a slightly cynical way say, it's kind of too bad to the students coming out of that wonderful facility that's the finest facility they'll probably ever see.
Yeah.
Now, you kind of spoke to that, saying there is a pipeline to using this level of equipment or education, but I'm curious, if it is far, if the facility is far beyond where they expect to work, or if that pipeline to Disney expects to sort of use all those graduates.
Yeah, good question. I expect that they needed to get some graduates who, you know, didn't have financial issues immediately upon graduation, you know, to really work with. Once they're exposed to all this wonderful stuff and then told what their real job is, maybe they'd rather flip burgers. But, you know, running these parks has to be, you know, more complicated than any of us give them credit for. And but the retirees were, you know, convinced that, you know, that this was a good program for, you know, for their former comrades.
From a manufacturing point, Full Sail relied on the new technology down there being kind of like donated or equipped with, because basically you put the candy out there and it's a trickle-down theory. It goes out to the studios with the students, and honestly, it just starts the landslide working. So if you've got them educated right off the front, you've got a basic crew to buy from you from here on out. So it's well worth it to throw it out there in place that teaches.
Yeah, I suppose so. It strains credulity that they're starting with Gen X and Harrison boards and, you know, that kind of stuff, when, you know, the lower priced people would be happy to have their equipment in there. So, you know, you don't know. I mean, you know, obviously somebody wanted to set them up right, and maybe I'm pretty sure that they got a special deal on the equipment. Because if it's Disney and they're buying Genelec speakers, you know, what's another dozen more? So if anybody wants a copy of this presentation, I'm happy to share it. Just send me an email. So any other questions?
This program has been a production of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society. Opinions expressed during this program are those of the individual speaking and not necessarily the opinion of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society.